We'll go ahead and get started, although we know people are still coming in from a very cold, blustery morning here in Washington. But welcome, everybody. My name is Nancy Lindborg. I'm the president of the U.S. Institute of Peace. And we're delighted to be able to host everybody here for a very important conversation. For those who haven't been to U.S. Institute of Peace before, we were founded in 1984 by Congress as an independent, federally funded institution dedicated to the proposition that peace is possible, that it is very practical, and it is essential for U.S. and international security. And so U.S. Institute of Peace pursues a vision of a world without violent conflict by working with partners around the world, individuals, organizations, governments, on what are the practical approaches, what are the tools, what's the training that you need to manage conflict so it doesn't become violent and to resolve it when it does. And so we're very happy to host today a conversation on a conflict that really galvanized the world at the time, the terrible killing fields in Cambodia and the peace process that ended that war, and what lessons do we learn from that. We're happy to have a distinguished set of panelists. And I know that there are many of you who are gathered here who have a deep association with the peace accords or with Cambodia, and we're especially honored to have with us here Mrs. Tilong Samura, who's joined us here, Mr. Sam Rainsy, and we also have the Venerable Yo Huat. Thank you, all of you, for joining, and other colleagues who have traveled from Cambodia. And we've left a lot of room in the conversation this morning for people to join in with their thoughts, their questions, their observations. So I hope everyone will do so. It was just 25 years ago in October that 19 governments gathered to sign the Paris Peace Accords, which were a comprehensive political settlement that laid out the process for ending two decades of the very brutal conflict that convulsed Cambodia. And we know that during that conflict under the Khmer Rouge, more than 1.7 million people lost their lives due to violence and famine. And it's interesting to look back and reflect on that as we see the terrible conflicts that are consuming the headlines today with similar numbers of and magnitude of suffering and difficulty in terms of resolving the conflicts. The Paris Peace Accords, and some of you here were involved with that, were the result of extensive negotiations with the world's powers involved, and it paved the way for the UN mission to supervise the ceasefire and launch a process of national reconciliation. So in the quarter decade since PPA, Cambodia has seen relative stability and economic growth, and it has definitely moved out of the poverty and famine that marked the two decades prior to the peace accords. Now has one of the fastest growing economies in Asia and a GDP that's growing more than 7% per year. So the conversation today is how has that quarter century of peace accord implementation worked? What lessons does it have for other conflicts? What can we learn in terms of the challenge of balancing stability and prosperity with human rights, with democracy, with reconciliation and justice, which are the critical issues when one is moving out of terrible conflict? I'm very happy that we have to moderate the panels today. Derek Mitchell, who knows these issues quite well, he is the former ambassador to Burma, where I first met him, where he did an extraordinary job of navigating a quite different but equally complicated transition process. He is a senior advisor to USIP's Burma program, and a really interesting perspective on countries in transition, having spent much of his career in Southeast Asia, including working at NDI and CSIS, and serving as a visiting fellow at Peking University School of International Studies. So I look forward to a very rich and informative conversation, and please join me in welcoming Ambassador Mitchell and the panelists.
I will stay seated, I think, since I will be moderating. But let me first say thank you to Nancy. I think it's been 6 months since I've started as senior advisor here. And the main reason I decided to come was because of Nancy Lindbergh. She does an absolutely outstanding job. She's an amazing leader and someone who's inspirational. So I want to thank you, Nancy, for what you do for USIP and what you've created here that I've been able to take part in. Let me also acknowledge before we start the person who made this thing really possible, today's event, this morning's event, Laura McGrew. She's an independent peacebuilder, scholar, and practitioner. She helped plan the event and will be writing up the conference report on the event. And where is Laura? And now there she is way in the back. So thank you very much, Laura, for all your great work in doing this. I am particularly pleased. I look out here, and it's great to see Southeast Asia hands. Good to see Cambodia hands. This is a country, even among Asianists, and I've worked at think tanks and done a lot of Asia work around town. This is a country that doesn't get enough attention, doesn't get its due in Washington. It's why doing this here at USIP is so pleasing to me and so refreshing. And yet, in its day, 25 years ago, which we are going to take a trip back 25 years, this was really one of the central defining countries of the late of the Cold War, of the ending days of the Cold War. We were just talking earlier that if you went up to the Hill 25, 30 years ago, you can get the leading congressmen and senators talking about this issue because all the major powers were involved. It was unfortunately sort of emblematic of how small countries were caught up in a tug of war of great power competition and suffered. Cambodia is really emblematic of the kind of tragedy of Cold War Southeast Asia. Now, the end of the Cold War offered an opportunity for change as the Cold War ended. And that was what we're talking about here, which is a peace process that was 10 years in the making. And that opportunity was seized. It is the only peace accord in which all of the P5 members were invested, were explicitly supportive of. I don't know if we can get that again in today's world, where all five P5 members can do that. It is unique, and it is also, I think, a unique responsibility of the great powers to deal with this. But of course, the end of the war was only the beginning of a very difficult peace. And we are going to look at that difficult peace later today. Of course, we have today the same leader that was in power in the 1980s. So you wonder, how have things gone since the peace accords? But as we look back, we will take stock of the agreement. We will think about lessons learned, things that we can learn about other peace agreements and what went right, what went wrong, and see what we can do to help with peace accords to come. The one sad part about today, unfortunate part, is that we don't have Richard Solomon here. We wanted to have Richard Solomon, who was central to all of this. I think all of you will recognize the tremendous contribution that he made to East Asian affairs, as well as this specific issue of the peace accords. But he couldn't make it this morning, but our thoughts are with him, not here. But we do have three amazing individuals who are also involved in this process firsthand, people who were there at the site. And I'll go one by one. I'll just introduce Mark first, Mark Sterella. He'll speak, and then I'll introduce Jim, and then on down the line. Mark Sterella, he serves now as Deputy Assistant Secretary in the Bureau of Population, Refugees, and Migration at the Department of State. He's been doing that just this year, I guess you started doing that. He was appointed DCM, Deputy Chief of Mission, in Phnom Penh in 2003, and as political officer in 1991 to 1994, and helped reestablish the U.S. presence in Cambodia after 17 years of absence. He worked in Paris from 1989 to 1991 and was a member of the U.S. delegation to the Paris conference, and what I understand was at the entire conference. You really witnessed it.
I missed the very end.
Missed the signing ceremony. But it was right there to see everything as it was happening and as it was negotiated. So he can speak to what he saw in terms of the negotiations and the dynamics. So we'll start with Mark to provide us that perspective. Thank you very much, Mark.
Okay. Nancy Lindbergh, Derek Mitchell, Lok Song, Ayadom, Lok Chom Tio, Puma Chitsunit Yetran, Chikit Yukapong Kapoor, Minokat, Chamoy Olok Loksarai, Tangani, Samrap Kapuchumni, Ompi Prawat Sat, Brad Adams is here, and Samora Chulong, certainly, and Sam Ranci as well, and many others who are in this room today. So I just want to say it's really an honor to be able to be with people who have been fighting for human rights for a long time. Derek has really set the stage, I think, extremely well, which means I'm going to have to throw away some of this. But let me just say that one of the best books written about Cambodia was written by our friend Elizabeth Becker, called When the War Was Over. And when we think about Cambodia and the scene when the Paris Accords were negotiated and signed, part of what was going on was that at the end of the Vietnam War in 1975, for the United States and for a lot of the world, people were tired. And they wanted to think the war was over. But everyone in Cambodia knows the war was not over. In some respects, the very worst was yet to come. The United States, in many respects, withdrew. But we knew what was going on in Cambodia. And it's important to note that George McGovern, senator, a peace dove on the Vietnam War, stood on the US Senate floor back in the 1970s while the Khmer Rouge were committing genocide in Cambodia and said, we should intervene here. But there was no support for it. The four factions were locked in war, and Cambodia, in many respects, was really frozen in time. As Derek said, at the end of the Cold War in 1989, there was a sense that things that were impossible before were suddenly possible. And the four factions that were fighting were in many respects exhausted. And the people of Cambodia were exhausted. They had suffered for so long. For the great powers, and it's very interesting that Derek mentions the role played by Dick Solomon. He was really at the center of corralling the Perm Five. Each of the Perm Five had an interest in seeing the war end. For the United States, we wanted to get behind supporting the CGDK, which included the Khmer Rouge, at the United Nations, in their presence at the United Nations. And we wanted to reintegrate with Southeast Asia, where we had strong interests. For the Soviet Union, which was in its last death throes in some respects, they were seeking an opportunity to be relevant and to try to support to the degree they could. I think Vietnam more than anyone else. China was in a very difficult time then. The reforms under Deng Xiaoping had not fully taken hold yet. They were trying to get the economy to take off. Just before the opening of the Paris Accords, there had been the events in Tiananmen Square, and China was finding itself isolated and supporting as an ally the much reviled Khmer Rouge, a very difficult position for China to enter the world in. France dedicated incredible energy and I would say tremendous intellect and creativity to supporting the Accords. I think they did it in part because of their longtime connections to the region and I think a hope to a degree that they could reestablish those connections. We all remember George Bush referring to the New World Order. So under the New World, things seemed like they were possible. The negotiations, which I spent 2 years doing, were amazing in many respects. Many of the people here were there at times. They were held in the Kleber Center in Paris, a gorgeous palace for conferences that had also hosted the negotiations on Vietnam. And I remember going with someone named, I think his name was Monsieur Le Petit, who was in charge of managing the Kleber Center. And he brought the American delegation with James Baker into the offices that they were giving us. And he turned to us with a smile and said, these were the offices the United States occupied for the Paris negotiations on Vietnam. So the French had a very strong sense of history. It was also the best catered negotiation in history. The French offered lunches every day, which seemed so out of tune with what was going on when we were dealing with a country where many people were starving. But it did make for great conversation. There was incredible leadership. A fellow by the name of Claude Martin, who was the director for Asia in the Quai d'Orsay. He was succeeded by Jean-David Levite, equally genius. Roland Dumas, the foreign minister of France. Ali Alatas of Indonesia, which showed that there really was a global approach to this negotiation. And over it all, then Prince Sihanouk playing a role that truly only Prince Sihanouk could play in all of this. I saw many times that in the negotiations, each great power was pulling one of the factions along. We would have negotiations during the day, and they would often go into the night. And then late at night, the U.S. delegation would walk out, and frequently we would meet with the Republicans, with Son Sann's people, and the French would meet with Phun Sen Pek, and the Soviets would meet with PRK, and the Chinese would go off and meet with the Khmer Rouge. And we each kept pulling towards the middle. To see what kinds of things were possible then, I remember in the opening of the Paris conference back in 1991, it was the first meeting between James Baker and Chinese Foreign Minister Chen Qichen since Tiananmen. And obviously there was some stiffness in all of this. We hit a snag in the negotiations right away in terms of how the negotiations would be set up. And Dick Solomon went into the office with Jim Baker, explained to him what we were facing. And I saw Jim Baker stand up, walk over to the Chinese offices, put his arm around Chen Qichen's shoulder, and walk out with him, offering him some jelly beans. The two of them talked, negotiated, and presented the conference with a solution that permitted us to go forward. As the negotiations went forward, there was always a sense of tragedy hanging over the talks. There was a vigil by venerables, monks, outside the Kleber Center that went on for almost 2 years, chanting and praying for peace. And everyone was aware, I think, that while the goal of the Paris Accords, first and foremost, was to restore peace in the region, that human rights was at the center, and the abuse of human rights was at the center of the tragedy of Cambodian history and had to be dealt with. So the Accords contained a number of guarantees on human rights. And if you read them, which I did last night, they somehow seem somewhat naive now, looking at them. The Accords committed the Cambodians themselves to respect human rights, and they committed the international community, I'm going to read what it said here, to promote and encourage respect for the observance of human rights and fundamental freedoms. But there was no enforcement mechanism. All there was a connection to the UN Human Rights Commission and an opportunity for a special rapporteur. Other compromises took place. I think it was very courageous for the Chinese to agree that elections would be the way that this peace would come about, knowing that the Khmer Rouge were going to do very poorly in those elections. Soviets must have worried about how Hun Sen's regime would do in those elections as well. The UNTAC mandate included, and we'll hear more about this, language on what kind of control UNTAC would have over the civil administration. And the language said, direct supervision or control. For 2 years, we debated what the word control meant. Was it control in the French sense of monitoring, or was it control in the English sense of actually directing? That compromise never permitted UNTAC in a way to do what many of us going in thought that it should do and would do. And I would note that Yasushi Akashi, the special representative, the Secretary General, always said, well, we are not an Article 6 of the UN Charter peacekeeping operation. But in fact, the mandate for UNTAC was under Article 6, which means that the UN did not have the right to use force. He said it was Article 6.5. That decision to put the mandate under Article 6 instead of under Article 7 meant in some ways that UNTAC was very limited in what it could do to compel the parties to go along with the provisions of the peace accords. I don't want to take up too much time here, but I do want to say that there was a debate when the Khmer Rouge refused to go along with many of the provisions related to disarming and cantonment elements, military elements of the Paris Accords. There was a question of whether or not UNTAC would use force, and I think many people in this room knew General Anderson, the Australian general who led the military component. He advocated for using force on behalf of the United Nations against the Khmer Rouge at that time. But it didn't happen for a variety of reasons, most importantly because of the nature of the mandate, which was a compromise. And one of the results of that was that UNTAC had to rely, in many respects, on the authorities of the PRK, the Hun Sen regime's civil administration and Ministry of Interior and Ministry of Defense to maintain order. That's a difficult position, I think, for any, you know, for any peacekeeping operation to be in. But if you're under Article 6, that's part of what happens. We're going to go on and hear more, but I want to say just a couple of things about the legacy of the Paris Accords and some of the lessons I see from it. One is we should not underestimate the importance of the Paris Accords and the success of the Paris Accords in ending a war that had caused incredible suffering, devastation, genocide, occupation for 17 years. That's an enormous achievement, and everyone who participated, I think, should feel good about that. As Derek said, Cambodia was reintegrated into the world. And there was an opportunity for openness, not just openness to commerce, although that was important, but openness to information, understanding the rest of the world, not feeling isolated, which I'm sure the Cambodian people felt very deeply and probably very painfully through those difficult years. The economic benefits were important, but I want to say one thing that's often overlooked is that 360,000 Cambodian refugees were repatriated safely from the camps in Thailand back into Cambodia in a process that was run by the most accomplished UN official of the time and maybe of recent times, Sergio Vieira de Mello. When we think about some of the challenges we're facing right now with huge numbers of refugees in conflict situations, we should be looking to the Paris Accords and seeing what elements there made that return of refugees possible that might be copied. And finally, I would say that something I was deeply involved in myself, and in fact my wife was also deeply involved in it, was the support for the development of civil society and a press that could advocate on behalf of human rights inside Cambodia. That has been a struggle. You can just ask Tun Sirai about what kind of struggle it has been, and he's not the only one, and I know four members of Ad Hoc are right now in prison. So it's remained a struggle. But I think that the Cambodian people who support human rights really look to the international community and ask, can you support us? What can you do for us under these circumstances? And in that, I'll just end by saying that the Paris Accords had a starting date, a date on which they went into force. There was no ending date. The Paris Accords are still in force. And the commitments of the different parties in those accords still apply, including for the Cambodians, but also for the international community. So getting back to where Derek started, the United States and the international community should not take their eyes away from Cambodia. We should continue to work on this issue because the job is not done. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark. That's a great way to frame everything and I think lay the foundation for a really interesting discussion later. Let me turn then to my good friend, James Scheer. I worked with when I was at DOD at the Pentagon in years past. He is now a global fellow at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars and a visiting professor at the Peacekeeping and Stability Operations Institute at the U.S. Army War College. As I say, he was Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Partnership Strategy and Stability Operations from 2009 to 2013, and as an advisor at the United Nations from 1989 to 94, he provided analytic support to the leadership of UN missions in Cambodia and former Yugoslavia, as well as assisted senior officials in shaping the implementation of the 1991 Gulf War ceasefire resolutions. He will speak, I think, for about 10 minutes on from the UNTAC perspective. You were involved much more in the implementation side, I guess, of things, but you can see how things were done implementation-wise after the accords were reached. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Derek, and it is a tremendous pleasure to be here. It's a great honor to be here with esteemed Cambodian colleagues, and as well, many of you who bring years of experience and expertise into this room and into this discussion. Can I ask quickly how many UNTAC alumni are in the room? Raise your hand, please. All right, good. Good. Excellent. My heartfelt thanks to you for your efforts to work on implementing the accord that Mark has described, how it was developed in tremendous detail. I wish I had heard that about 20 years ago, actually. and a lot of it rings true in terms of how the great powers were working together occasionally to move this peace process forward, a truly historic moment in early post-Cold War history. So let me address retrospectively some of the challenges UNTAC faced, and I will say up front, I do not bring any deep expertise on Cambodia or Southeast Asia to this discussion. My expertise is more in the functional peacekeeping domain, and I am at the Army War College, so I will start by adding that my views here are purely personal, and I hereby absolve any entities of the U.S. government from any association with my half-baked or contentious views. The peacekeeping world was greatly enthused but greatly challenged by this opportunity to work in the furtherance of a very important agreement. Let me offer two retrospective insights and then very clearly, quickly, eight lessons. Very quickly. Two insights. First insight, to build on what Mark has already said, the conditions for a peace process at the time, the geopolitical conditions were very auspicious, very favorable. At the national level, there was a stalemated civil war. If Professor Bill Zartman were here, he'd say, yes, this fits into my model of a self-herding stalemate. There was a lack of an internationally recognized government. Cambodia was largely isolated. I'd also add that the Khmer Rouge were clearly withering on the vine. That is not something that a lot of us who went in from the outside understood initially until we began to engage at local levels. I wonder if there are any members of Colombia's FARC rereading history on this. But their outer core of cadre were defecting. It was clear. They were losing support. The inner core around Pol Pot was still there and still loyal. At the first meeting, or one of the first meetings of the Supreme National Council, the party head, Khieu Samphan, showed up, and quite frankly, some of my colleagues were surprised he wasn't wearing a Maoist tunic suit. He was wearing a very nice Western suit, probably bought in Bangkok. And we were wondering, this is the ideological tenacity of the KR may be waning in some ways. So there was a loss of support, and the whole terrible history that Cambodia suffered through during their rule and so forth was clearly a part of that. So that was the national piece. The regional piece, there were great powers working. I would also say there was growing interest regionally, given that all the neighboring states and largely the members of ASEAN were signatories to this agreement, and that played an important role. My immediate boss, the special representative Yasushi Akashi, Japanese, was chosen in part because his country, Japan, wanted to play a greater role in the region. I remember his first trip to Washington. He was very pleased that Secretary of State, then Secretary James Baker, was up on Capitol Hill saying, we have to support this UN mission. We have to put our money where our mouth is and do it. And he exclaimed that to the then Deputy Larry Eagleburger. Eagleburger's response to Mr. Akashi was, sir, how do you translate that into Japanese? And Akashi smiled and said, the response, the translation is, no taxation without representation, which fit in terms of Security Council membership, which Japan was seeking at the time. But it also, I think, bespeaks the growing role of Asian powers in the Southeast Asian region. Indonesia was certainly a player, too, and the immediate neighbors as well. So that was the regional piece. And as for the global piece, which has already been discussed, Soviet Union was collapsing basically 2 months after the accord was signed. Their proxies were leaving everywhere. Foreign forces were leaving. Contrast that to today's world, where foreign forces are, in many cases, the real core problem. Vietnamese leaving Cambodia, Cubans leaving various parts of Africa, Soviets themselves having pulled out of Afghanistan a bit earlier. So it was, as I have sometimes called it, an era of constructive disengagement. And it opened the door for a generally consensus-based Security Council at the time to work actively on peace and security problems. And in the midst of all that, the four major Khmer factions I see saw the constructive pressures to stay inside the process, to work in an inclusive way, rather than to be out in the cold, to be separate. And that's what led to the Paris Accords and all that followed. Insight number two, the implementation process did not live up to the huge expectations. And I would say also it ended up being very elections-centric. And some of you who work as professionals in the peace-building, peace-transition process know the challenges of working with electoral pillars as the dominant ones. The key missions that UNTAC was a organization of 16,000 peacekeepers from over 30 countries, and another 7,000 or 8,000 civilians, both police that came in from foreign countries as well as international and local civilian hires. Very large organization, slow to get on the ground, which was a big challenge, with a hugely significant but almost impossible to implement mandate. Verify the ceasefire, monitor the departure and non-return of foreign forces, although most of the Vietnamese forces had already left by then. Prepare for and assist the Cambodians in conducting national elections. Supervise and control, and again, that's absolutely right, the word control was nebulous, to ensure a neutral political environment for the elections. And I would say the leadership guidance was, it's the neutral political environment that we are aspiring to achieve. All of these tasks and others were very, very challenging. And the process began to unravel, frankly, within weeks after the initial start. The KR, Khmer Rouge, were the first to bolt. They shifted from a posture of cautious cooperation to passive boycott. We were hearing from their field commanders that they were actually ready to cantone and disarm. But at a political level, their representatives at the Supreme National Council and elsewhere complained that the Paris Accords were not being properly implemented, that the Vietnamese are still in country. And I think, quite frankly, looking back, it may have been KR disappointment that the departure of Vietnamese and Soviet support did not lead to the state of Cambodia's collapse, to the Hun Sen regime's collapse. Whatever their motivations in the end, the impacts were twofold. First of all, disarmament, demobilization was essentially off the table. There were over 250, maybe 300,000 Cambodian fighters from the four factions, both the militia as well as government-based. Maybe 70,000 as a consequence of voluntary cantonment came in, but only several hundred Khmer Rouge fighters at the end of the day. So there was no disarmament, cantonment, and reintegration. And as a consequence, the state of Cambodia started to press hard back on civil administration oversight. I remember my first day, we got access to the Cambodia Ministry of Defense. We walked through. It was vacant. No one was there. They had all been moved out by Hun Sen. They were somewhere else outside of Phnom Penh, not available to us. Thank you very much. So oversight, pressing back on oversight was a huge challenge. In spite of all this, in December of 1992, with UNTAC's recommendation, the Secretary General's support, and Security Council's support, the UN decided to press ahead with national elections. It was a very risky strategy, premised on the calculation that the Khmer Rouge could be fenced in. They did not control a lot of territory. There were some contested territory, but of this 179 or almost 200 districts, only a small number were controlled by the Khmer Rouge. And I would say, and I would give John Sanderson, General Sanderson, a great credit for this, he figured out ways to redeploy the UNTAC force away from the DDR centric mission to support for the electoral, to the security of the electoral process. And I think that was a huge step forward. There was also a very popular voter registration program that got ramped up. International sanctions were being applied to make sure there was outside support, and I can tell you more about that a little later. But the door to the Khmer Rouge to come back in was left open. It wasn't absolutely shut. And UNTAC worked hard on thwarting voter intimidation. The biggest concern for Cambodian citizens was, will my vote be secret? And UNTAC worked very hard on ensuring that and on communicating that. There were some other consequences, but that was a very important mission. As it turned out, the elections in May of 1993 were conducted. They were technically very sound and widely acclaimed as a very positive step forward. Almost 90% of registered Cambodians went to the polls in early monsoon rains. KR cadre were present in many of these polling sites, and that was a security concern, but they did not interfere. They did not generally create threats. As a result, the royalist Phun Sen Pek party won a plurality, about 45%. Hun Sen's party drew about 38%, and a power-sharing deal was reached until it was, of course, upset 4 years later in 1997 with the coup. Quick lessons, very quickly. Number one, transitions. War to peace transitions do not end with elections. Focusing on a neutral political environment is a necessary but definitely not a sufficient condition for success. There should have been more investments on peace building and security sector reform. There was something called a mixed military working group, which was operationally effective in coordinating during UNTAC's mission with national forces, but there was no afterwards, and that was a real problem. Lesson two, work very hard with the neighbors and especially external patrons. And here I give SRSG Akashi great credit. One of the biggest moments in the history of the mission was actually when a Chinese engineering unit in Kampong province was attacked by KR. Several of the engineers were killed. The next day, Akashi was on a flight to Beijing to say, look what your local partner is doing. You really have to rethink and work very hard on constraining your support for that. We also, UNTAC in the strategic investigations area, worked hard on a sort of name and shame strategy for illegal timber extraction and illegal mineral extraction from the West, where we had helicopters. This was the pre-drone era, by the way. Helicopters would go in. Photos would be taken of license plates of trucks hauling out the timber illegally. There was a ban on that. And Mr. Akashi and others would take that information to neighboring states and say, look, we've got this. You've got to cut this down. So there was absolute, and I would say broadly constructive, pressure on neighbors to get along and work in support of the process. Lesson three, leadership counts, absolutely. I think Akashi's great benefit was he knew Prince Sihanouk, later King Sihanouk, had worked hard on the Prey Vahir border issue previously. He knew Cambodia extremely well. brought some Japanese, positive Japanese background into this, and General Sanderson, very high regard for him too. Lesson four, managing expectations is extraordinarily hard. Untaxed proclivity not to use force, despite some of Sanderson's hopes. Disappointed some Cambodians, and at the time, there was a view that UNTAC might be seen as a Desert Storm operation, because Desert Storm, after the invasion of Kuwait, had just been conducted earlier. So would UNTAC really be a Chapter 7 peace enforcement mission? And as was said earlier, the 6.5 posture wasn't quite there. So there was disappointment that the operation was not taking on more effort on that. Lesson five, look for and always build in any peace process intercommunal dependencies. Many of us know the very challenges that citizens of Vietnamese descent in Cambodia have suffered over the years as fishing communities on the Mekong or the Tonle Sap. And the challenges which have, there was violence against them at the time and subsequently. The initial draft of the Cambodian Constitution did not recognize them as citizens either, which was a challenge. But if you're a fisherman on a lake, you probably are in, you've got a good partnership with street vendors in the marketplace downstream. So. There may be opportunities. I ran into this big time in the Balkans, which was my punishment for good behavior after leaving Cambodia in 93. So look for communal interdependencies. Lesson six, avoid winners and losers. As part of the information campaign to keep your vote will be kept secret, 300,000 radios were distributed throughout Cambodia's community, so you could listen and hear this message being delivered. The problem was some people in some communities didn't get those radios and they were very upset. There was actually some violence that was triggered by this distribution. So avoid unintended consequences, do no harm. Lesson seven, justice and accountability certainly cannot be ignored. I will defer to our colleague Priscilla here for more discussions on more insights on that. The Paris Accords did, for not surprising reasons given the parties, it did prohibit the retrospective application of criminal law. Now, the tribunal was set up later to deal with Khmer Rouge violations during, you know, as a consequence of the auto genocide. But the peace process and the Paris Accords, they did trumpet the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and said the policies and practices of the past shall not be allowed to return. So going forward is not return to the past. But justice and accountability issues did loom large. Last lesson, don't forget the U.S. Congress. You've already said that. In fact, at the time, Cambodia was of great concern to a member of Congress, a number of whom had served in Vietnam during that era, Senators John McCain, both Senators Kerry, Senator Chuck Robb, then of Virginia, Congressman Tom Ridge at the time, and a number of others. So it was an important piece to bear in mind. I've overstretched, so I am going to stop and desist now, and happy to turn it over to colleagues. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Jim, that was really wonderful and very specific in terms of the lessons learned and the recommendations. So really very, very grateful. If I may say, too, one of the drivers, the engines of this event as well, is someone in the U.S. Congress that many of you know, Paul Grove, who has taken a personal interest in this and also official interest in this up in Congress. So I want to note his contributions over the years to Cambodia and to issues in Southeast Asia. Let me turn now to our final speaker, Priscilla Hayner, who is an independent writer and consultant on peace and justice. and has written widely on the subject of transitional justice, and specifically official truth-seeking in political transitions. She co-founded the International Center for Transitional Justice and has worked as a consultant or a senior advisor to a number of UN agencies and NGOs. She is now completing a book on how peace negotiations have grappled with justice for war crimes. And she will speak on the issue of Cambodia in a comparative context and think about the justice provisions in the peace accord in Paris. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Derek. It's a pleasure to be here and to join my fine panelists. And it's, I have to say, a very impressive audience we have of many people who clearly were directly involved in the Paris talks. So I hope that time will allow for a robust discussion and further, not just questions, but further input from many of you who actually were very close to the talks. I was certainly not at the Paris talks, nor am I an expert in any sense on Cambodia, although I've certainly watched Cambodia over the years with much interest. And I was asked today to speak, as Derek said, from more of a comparative perspective based on work I've done over the last years, looking very closely at a number of other peace negotiations over the years, and specifically the question of how issues of accountability for crimes of the war have been handled, as well as the impact of international justice on peace negotiations, especially with the beginning of the International Criminal Court, how that has changed the ground in front of us a bit. So when you look at the Paris Peace Accord, of course it's striking and it's known for the fact that somehow it doesn't deal with past crimes. In fact, another way to look at that is that it does look, of course, at the issue of refugees in return and is very explicit on that issue. It also addresses specifically an agreement to release all detainees, prisoners of war or civilians who are detained for whatever reason in terms of their involvement in the armed struggle or the political struggle. So in a sense, without saying it, essentially providing an amnesty for those persons without review. But that didn't provide an amnesty explicitly. No, it certainly wasn't an amnesty into the future for others who were not then detained. But what's important, I think, comparatively, is that the accord doesn't address, of course, criminal accountability for crimes of the past. It also did not include anything around looking at the truth, such as a truth commission, which has become more common in more recent years, or other kinds of victim-focused programs. So when I talk about criminal accountability, truth measures, and victim-focused programs, that's sort of 10 years later is what started to be called sort of a collection of measures called transitional justice. But at the time, transitional justice as a term didn't exist actually yet. And as reflected in the language of the accord, that isn't present. Now, I would be curious, and I do not know what the conversations might have been behind the scenes on these issues. It would be impossible that there were not discussions, of course, a recognition of the history of Cambodia. It's impossible, of course, to not be cognizant of that. And you can see that suggested in the references to not repeating or non-return of the policies and practices of the past. For example, I would certainly be interested because looking at many other cases, it is often true that you find very interesting sets of discussions that took place that you won't see necessarily in the language. You often won't see in the language. So it would be perhaps in the course of today interesting to hear whether some of those discussions were taking place and whether certain decisions were made that resulted in the language that we see. So when you look back comparatively, I think it's safe to say that things have changed, but in some ways, things are very, very similar still today in terms of this peace-justice tension. So at the time, in 1991, and in the couple of years thereafter, when there were several other important peace agreements around the world, it was actually common to not include reference to justice for past crimes, or certainly not in any manner of providing robust accountability. So if you look at the peace agreement for El Salvador that was signed just a few months later in early 1992, Mozambique, which was also later in 1992, and even South Africa a couple of years after, none of these, with the exception of El Salvador, none of these included criminal accountability in any sense. The El Salvador Accord stood apart because it did include reference to a truth commission and to a fairly robust vetting mechanism where quite a number of senior officials were removed from the armed services for human rights crimes. But even South Africa, which we now think of as the example of such a widely known Truth and Reconciliation Commission and various other victim-focused measures and reparations, those measures were not included actually in the agreement, which was in the form of an interim constitution, but developed over the following years, which starts to hint at something that we see in many other places as well. If you compare some of these agreements of 25 or so years ago to today, we now, of course, are starting to see, relatively recently, some agreements with fairly robust justice components. And certainly, if you look at the agenda of the talks, the issue of justice, which is sometimes called victims and sometimes called reconciliation, or sometimes called human rights more generally, often this is a main issue of the talks. The Colombian agreement, which was recently agreed, finally signed and finalized and passed in Congress in Colombia, that was a four-year process, and over a year and a half of those 4 years were specifically dedicated to the issue, the agenda item that they called victims, which was specifically this basket of how to deal with crimes of the past, which the FARC, as the rebel group, was very interested in having clarity on, as was the government. In some earlier agreements, and still common today, there's often a specific focus on having any amnesty that might be included in a peace agreement very explicit in excluding international crimes. So if there's a number of agreements that took place in the late 1990s and the early 2000s where there was an amnesty agreed, because of course one needs an amnesty for political acts such as taking up arms against the state in order to reintegrate fighters and others, but it's important to exclude war crimes, crimes against humanity, genocide, and other international crimes or commitments under international treaties that the state has undertaken. If you look at the debate around peace and justice, that's also interestingly very similar. So in 1990, a year before the Paris Accord was signed, Amnesty International put out a statement calling for a robust inclusion of human rights issues in the talks and in the agreement for Cambodia, and specifically focused in part on the need for accountability for past crimes. And the argument that they use was that of deterrence, that if you don't include accountability, you'll have more crimes in the future. That's very similar, in fact, to the argument still used today from a human rights perspective, that if we don't have accountability, we'll have further human rights crimes in the future. What's difficult is that, in fact, from the perspective of those that are working very hard for peace or working just to stop ongoing violence and conflict, from their perspective, if you don't find the peace, then you will have more abuses that become part of, that are very much part of the war, and you will certainly have more victims. So you see the immediate tension of people saying, listen, we're working for peace. We don't see the parties willing to put themselves on trial and ultimately possibly serve time in jail, and therefore the first priority is to stop the war, whereas from a human rights perspective, the argument continues to be, if you don't have accountability, you will have further abuses. And I think the one thing that we can be clear about is that to pretend that somehow this is an easy issue to be resolved, or that there isn't a tension between those two positions, would be dishonest and false. There is a tension there, and it is a tension that peacemakers and parties to peace agreements, even if they have quite good intentions in some cases, they struggle with this, and it's a very difficult issue to resolve. Now, if you look at why there has been why has there been a change over time so that we are seeing more robust inclusion of human rights issues, and particularly dealing with past crimes? Of course, as I hinted earlier, the main effect is that of the creation of the International Criminal Court. So when that came online, it was agreed in 98, it came into force in 2002. In those countries where the ICC has had jurisdiction, it has forced the parties to talks and the mediators to essentially find some resolution if they feel that they're at risk of the ICC intervening, and if their priority is to avoid criminal justice or avoid the leadership being sent to The Hague. So places like Uganda, talks that took place 10 years ago, and Colombia, which has just concluded, you see actually the creation of new domestic or domestically based tribunals that would satisfy the requirements of the ICC through what is called the complementarity test. So if you have sufficient justice at the national level, the ICC will not intervene with investigations and prosecutions. So you have seen a strong influence by the knowledge that the ICC is watching and may in fact take up cases in the country. But it isn't just the ICC effect. It's also a general strengthened international attention and prioritization of these issues, an increased expectation and sort of a sense of stricter standards. And you see this in part reflected in the Security Council's resolutions that often now make reference to human rights and past crimes in some cases. And also another important point in time was in 1999, the United Nations Secretary General put out to his own representatives a policy on how his representatives should engage in peace negotiations, which explicitly said the United Nations was not to recognize or sign on to any amnesty for international crimes. So where there are UN representatives in processes, that has become de facto a strong limitation or push against any flirtation with certainly broad amnesties or other explicit impunities. Let me just perhaps conclude by saying that one strong trend that we see coming through, and Cambodia is very much reflective of this, is that even in those places where countries believe they have settled issues around justice in a peace agreement, it turns out that there's many other issues around it, particularly around human rights and justice for past crimes, that continue to effectively be negotiated in the following years. So in certainly there's peace agreements where the language was not explicit and it sort of leaves open the door for further discussions. But even in those countries where it's relatively explicit what the intention of the parties were, the issues around human rights for serious crimes of the war tend to not go away. They tend to continue to be very much debated. There are new initiatives. There may be new courts created, as we have seen in Cambodia, and other truth commissions years later. So we see that this is an issue that, in fact, is very hard to put to bed, in fact, with a signature on a peace agreement, and tends to stay alive for quite a number of years into the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Priscilla. Again, three excellent presentations. I'd like to, we have about 20 minutes, and I do want to get to questions from the audience, but let me ask a broad question here, somewhat from my own recent experience. There are two things that Jim said that really stuck out. I think he made some great recommendations, six or seven of them, or observations. But two comments he made, I think, are particularly salient here. Transitions don't end with elections, which is a truism that is not often remembered. Elections are sexy moments that everybody, you know, grabs onto and sees, and then people move on. But transitions don't end at elections. And secondly, the notion of building intercommunal dependencies, which is a notion of that I think about. Often peace processes, depending on the country, but typically it's not just peace that's being built, but a nation that's being built or put back together, or sometimes really just being built in some ways for the first time. So given that there's a conversation about the future of the country and the future of this nation, new nation that is being built in essence, or reformed, the issue of inclusivity, of who's in the room having these conversations, becomes very important. It gets to the conversations about transitional justice and whether people feel they need to have certain needs met, or they may make the decision, as you say, that certain things are more important than accountability urgently in the near term. We need to have peace first, get our lives back, and then deal with those questions later. And so you have, in some ways, a more stable peace because you have a more inclusive peace underwritten by a majority of the people. So let me just ask the question to each of you, I guess, because I think it crosses each of them. And I guess that issue of whether transitional justice was discussed as you during your time. Did you see that at all, part of the conversation? Do you feel that the process was inclusive enough? Is it a lesson learned that they could have been more inclusive? Or was it just that great powers were such in a rush at this opportunity to pull a piece together, get the elections over and move on? Jim, do you have observations on this as well, given that this is a recommendation of yours of how it was implemented? Was there something that wasn't there in the accords or in the negotiation of the accords that made it harder for UNTAC? And then, Priscilla, your thoughts about all this as well.
Well, let me start by saying that transitional justice as such was barely discussed in the accords. And in fact, we had a lot of trouble dealing with even how to describe what had happened in the negotiations. If you look at the accords under the human rights provisions, you'll see a phrase that says that everyone is committed to ensuring that the policies and practices of the past shall not be allowed to return. The word genocide couldn't be used. That word was debated. I can't remember if Samora, you were there, but it was debated for weeks whether or not we could describe what happened in a way that would put a word on it that we all agreed to. Chinese simply would not agree to it. And I remember a crazy evening where Claude Martin and Prince Sihanouk spent the entire night discussing this and trying to come up with some kind of an arrangement. They could not come up with an arrangement, and the word genocide was not even included in the negotiations. So given where the parties were and given the way we looked, transitional justice issues, as Priscilla said, were really not on the table very much then. That was a bridge too far. In terms of the inclusiveness of the accords, frankly, it's extraordinary that the Khmer Rouge were at the table. Not only was Khieu Samphan at the table, Son Sen, who was personally responsible for murders of lots and lots of people, was at the table with James Baker. It was amazing that this was permitted. But I remember that the Khmer Rouge arrived. I was there on a plane at Po Chin Tong Airport, and were brought to the house that they had set up for themselves. And the PRK staged a huge demonstration. That demonstration led to that house, and the house was attacked with the Khmer Rouge leadership, including Khieu Samphan, in the house. Khieu Samphan had a cord wrapped around his neck. People were trying to hang him. This was a put-up riot, incidentally. This was not spontaneous at all. I talked with the people who were part of it. They were told they were all bussed in. They weren't really sure what they were doing. They were told to go to places. But I think that hurt the inclusiveness. From the first day of the Khmer Rouge's participation in Phnom Penh, they were physically under attack. So I, I can understand, I mean, why this would happen. But frankly, I think we didn't do a good enough job on inclusiveness, even though it was incredibly hard for the United States to sit at the same table with the Khmer Rouge.
Thank you very much for those provocative questions. I'll, on justice and accountability, I'll defer to more knowledgeable colleagues on that. But I do understand totally the history and fascinating personal accounts of that. On the inclusion issue, this featured very prominently in UNTAC leadership's calculation about how to manage what I've sometimes called analogy is a controlled crash landing, if you will, for the implementation, because it was unraveling. And with the Khmer Rouge backing off, it was a big problem. But our colleagues, and in part because of their enormous capacity, I give credit for Ambassador Tim Carney. I'm not sure if he's here today, but Tim was very key to this. He was UNTAC's lead on the information side. And knowledge, and Sergio Vieira de Mello played a role in this too, in terms of understanding the dynamics within Cambodia's districts and provinces where Khmer Rouge had some presence or control. And it became very clear, first of all, that the withering on the vine phenomena was real. The outer core of cadre were defecting. They wanted to have livelihoods. They wanted work. They wanted to marry the girl in the next village. They did not want to head back to the past, to the ideological purity, if you will, of that ideology and all it led to. So practical engagement to include became critical. Infrastructure repair, basic roads so farmers could get stuff to market. The passage of 300 plus thousand refugees coming across the border from Thailand back into Cambodia was a key driver here too. And I think that UNTAC, as it was adjusting and shifting to try and fence in the Khmer Rouge influence, especially with the elections looming, they decided in favor of an approach toward inclusion. Did it work in all provinces and all areas? No. I'm sure there were specific cases where there was disappointment. But I would say overall inclusion was a strong preference predisposition of UNTAC's leadership as the process went forward. I've also seen inclusion work well in other contexts, you know. Upstream and downstream communities need each other, you know, and I saw this in central Bosnia. You need road access. You have to go through a village with another. Oh, and that's the other thing, too. The ethnic cleavages within Cambodia, while definitely there in some cases, were small in relation to the ideological cleavage that drove between the communist and non-communist factions and actually among the communist factions. And that is a different era in many respects. But inclusion is an important piece in getting beyond that. Priscilla.
I mean, just very briefly to leave time for other questions, but it would be interesting to sort of do the mental exercises to, if you held the Paris peace talks today, what would they look like, both in terms of agenda and in terms of participation? And, you know, certainly in the field of peace negotiations, one of the magic words right now is inclusivity. And we've seen some very interesting examples of that recently, such as direct victims, many dozens of them coming in officially to speak with the parties in Havana when the parties to Colombia, the process were speaking, and they had formal days where they presented and engaged and I'm told brought the parties to tears in hearing the stories from the victims, and it affected then the conclusion of the talk. So, I mean, that's perhaps the furthest we have seen of an example of inclusion, especially directly of victims, but there's various other ways of including, be it through side meeting, through position papers, through NGOs, through, of course, the importance of having women at the table. All of those things are given much more attention today than they were even just a few years ago. So it'd be interesting to think about that question. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Okay, let me leave it open to folks with The gentleman in the back, please.
My name is Sonoro Prom. I'm the chairman of the Cambodia-America Alliance. I hear the panelists mention about the reason of the Paris Peace Agreement is to restore peace and to guarantee human rights. And the lack of enforcement is a weakness of the PPI. Also, the House Resolution 728 mentioned about free and fair election, which is part of human rights, and also release of political prisoner. Here, Cambodia-America Alliance have two proposals that would help correct this lack of enforcement. One of them is the initiative of the Heritage Foundation, that is the water lawman and Olivia Enos, that suggesting that unite to shorten the 18 country signatory to 6 countries, including United States, England, France, Indonesia, Japan, and Australia. And also, the second initiative is Ambassador Salmon himself. In 2012, the Cambodian community come here in this building. He recommended to use smartphone. We didn't pay much attention to that. Here what the Cambodia-America Alliance recommend. We should use the Cambodia contact group to make sure that the election would be free and fair. Japan already taking care of the pre-election. Now, during the election, to prevent intimidation, cheating, computerizing, all this kind of thing, you should have international observer. And to have one international observer per every polling station. Also, we should have the Cambodian observer. The Cambodian observer armed with the smartphone. Why? Because during 2013, they formed so-called 1104. When they
sir, we don't have a whole lot of time. I do want to get to other questions. Okay. Do you have a question here quickly?
That's we would like to ask the panel to recommend. We send the recommendation to the Congress and the Senate to implement these two proposals. Would you care to comment on that? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let's take two questions and then we can have comments on them. The gentleman in the front, please.
Well, thanks a lot, Mr. Chairman Prom Sonora. I'm Vibol Du, I'm the president of Cambodian American Alliance. Mm-hmm. I have two questions. One is get a short mark, finish the conclusion, very important. United States don't leave Cambodia alone. So my question is how we start from here with new administration coming, what kind of policy, foreign policy in Southeast Asia. And number two, I would like to touch on with Priscilla, I'll talk about ICC. Cambodian American Alliance worked with international lawyer, Mr. Richard Roger, filed a complaint to the ICC about human rights violation. And can you just dig down a little bit on ICC role, how they advance from here? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So let's leave those two questions open, Mark.
Let me start by saying that in the United States, we don't have the concept of first prime minister and second prime minister. We have one president at a time. And so I would rather not speculate, if you'll permit, on what the new administration, what their approach will be. So I'm afraid that I'm not in a good position to answer that question. But I do want to say that the recommendations regarding engagement are the right recommendations no matter which administration is there. The United States is present in Cambodia. We have an enormous amount of trade with Cambodia. We're engaged in a lot of foreign assistance to support Cambodians. And under the Paris Accords, we have a responsibility to remain engaged. So I think we should remind ourselves of that, and we should stick with it. The recommendations that the other gentleman made regarding elections, some of that is absolutely fundamental ensuring transparency for elections and using what technologies exist now to help in that process. So I would just say I think those are good ideas. I can't say on all of them that you listed, but the general concepts I think are right. Thank you.
I broadly concur with the point about electoral support and transparency. The only question I would ask is, what will be the, what I would call the perturbation effects? How will the local communities react to an international presence deliberately there? If they see it as a partnership, as something to enhance and encourage their participation, that's positive. But yeah, there needs to be a good understanding of that impact. Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, obviously, I can't speak for the ICC or for the prosecutor's office. They receive, I mean, I do know they receive, of course, many complaints, which they welcome and encourage, both from states' parties and from non-states' parties. And they look at those, and usually they are eventually in communication, or certainly they are if they intend to inquire further. But I, unfortunately, can't speak for them in any sense. Sorry.
Well, thank you. Thank you for the questions. Others, please, sir.
I'm Sam Rensi, the leader of the opposition in Cambodia. One of the lessons to be drawn from the respect or non-respect of the Paris Peace Agreement is the respect of the election result, the respect of the will of the people. In 1993, the ruling party, the Cambodian People's Party, did lose the election. And they refused to accept the implementation of the will of the people. And they threatened with secession. Unfortunately, the Cambodian, the other sides, and UNTAC gave in and accept this threat and this blackmail. So we are going to have other crucial election next year. And as the United Democratic Opposition, we are very confident following the formation of a new electoral commission, following the desire of the people for a change. We expect that the people will express their will properly and will be reflected properly in an acceptably free and fair election. What would happen then if, again, the ruling party reject the result of the election? So we call on the signatories of the Paris Peace Agreement not to make the same mistake, and at least to warn them that any government formed after such a threat and after such a refusal to respect the will of the people will not be recognized, will be delegitimized, and the international community should speak with one voice, because it is the credibility of the international community to come up with an agreement. An agreement is blatantly violated in that way. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And again, it's great to have you here this morning and hear your voice here in Washington. Let me extend on that and ask a broad question then. According to the Accords, I mean, what is the responsibility, the role of the P5? I mean, I think it was raised at one point about their signatories, their support, this whole process, that you said the peace agreement is still in force, and therefore we should not forget that we have signed this, as have others. What was the thought at the time about our role and responsibility, and how would you think about the question if democracy continues and human rights continues to recede? What responsibility we have to enroll, according to the Accords, to get involved somehow.
Let me start by saying that His Excellency Sam Rensi points out one of the great problems of that election, that when it was over, one party won a plurality of the votes and did not end up ruling. It appears that that happens in other countries, too, depending on the Constitution. And the Constitution, such as it was at the time, was the Paris Accords. And one of the compromises that was most important in the Paris Accords that was intended to protect the rights of smaller parties was that the Constituent Assembly had to approve the new Constitution by a two-thirds majority. That meant effectively that if you had a third of the votes, which two parties did, Phuong Sin Pek and the CPP, you could block adoption of the Constitution. And that meant the whole thing would have come to a stop. So I would say that that existed then. That's not the Constitution of Cambodia today. And I think that Cambodia should try as hard as it can to stick with the Constitution as it is today, which does not require two-thirds majority to form a government. In terms of the role of, the, I think it was 17 signatory countries, but maybe I remember them right. 18?
Plus Cambodia.
I read what is there, that the commitment is to promote and encourage respect for and observance of human rights and fundamental freedoms. I think we should renew the commitment, and we should talk amongst ourselves about the need to renew the commitment. And we have the UN Human Rights Council, which has a specific responsibility in the Paris Accords to maintain monitoring of human rights. So we have some vehicles for that. But we shouldn't, I think, assume that, how shall I put this? At some level, a nation like Cambodia really has to be the master of its own fate. And other countries cannot, in the end, solve all the problems of any country. And that's a difficult thing. But if you read through the Paris Accords, there are extensive references to the commitment of all the parties to respect the sovereignty of Cambodia. And that was very, very important, as you know, to all of the parties there, in part because Cambodia had been under occupation. And so those commitments to sovereignty were really important. So I think we have a balance here, but I want to return to where I was before. The signatories have a commitment to remain engaged on human rights and democracy. Thank you.
We're past time, but anything for someone?
I think it's, I very much agree that with the idea of renewing the commitment, it's hard because many peace agreements do sort of continue into the future. As you say, they don't typically have an end date. The point is that they're implemented. But in fact, usually one does need to then reach back to that sort of firm commitment of whoever the signatories are. And in this case, of course, you have very important states involved. So if there were a way to formally sort of renew that commitment, if that isn't clear somehow, that would be helpful in perhaps a more robust way than relying on something from 25 years ago when so many things have taken place since. Thank you.
Thank you. And as I said at the start, it's a unique agreement because it did have the P5, and I'm not sure you can get the P5 back today to renew, but everyone does have that responsibility to look at why they signed it and what's in that agreement 25 years later. I think what we've done is set the table very well. It was a very good conversation. I learned an enormous amount from the three folks to my left. We will continue the conversation in 15 minutes with talking about sort of the results and the realities post-Paris peace agreement. One of the great things about these types of events is so many people in this room, many of you may not have seen each other in a while. So hopefully you take the opportunity between the sessions to talk and engage and get caught up. But please join me in thanking our three panelists for the discussion. Thank you all very much. We'll see you in a moment.
Ladies and gentlemen, obviously it was a good idea to have time for catching up. Many good connections I observed and still going on. But in the interest of time, let me unfortunately ask you to take your seats and let's begin our second panel. My name is Scott Worden. I'm the director of the Afghanistan and Central Asia program here at the U.S. Institute of Peace. So on the surface, an unlikely candidate to be moderating this panel. However, my first really international development job was working in Cambodia for the Cambodian Defenders Project and also for the Open Society Justice Initiative. And I lived there from 2003 to 2005. And so Cambodia has a special spot and importance for me. And obviously the theme of this conference being the reminiscing, but also looking at the legacy and the implementation of peace accords is very dear to U.S. Institute of Peace's mission. I think that our design is working well for this panel. We had a set of excellent presentations on the first panel to recall and describe the circumstances of the peace accords, some about their early implementation, and framing that in the context of peace agreements generally. And on this panel, we're going to look at how that all worked out. So we have a set of distinguished panelists who have covered Cambodia over years and can really comment on how the fundamentals of the accords that we just heard about have played out over time. As was mentioned by Nancy Lindborg in her introduction, in some ways the peace accords are seen as a success in that there has not been a return to civil war. There has been economic growth, albeit from a very low level. And there are some elements of Cambodia that are working well. On human rights, on justice issues, as was noted, there still needs to be more progress. And it's interesting to think about, you know, this general contrast, which I don't think has to be a choice and should not be a choice, but this contrast between stability versus human rights is an issue that I think plays out in Cambodia as well as many other countries. And so in this panel, we're going to ask and hear from very knowledgeable Cambodia experts and scholars about how have 25 years on, how has the implementation over time achieved the ideals of the agreement, and how hasn't it? So without further ado, let me introduce the whole panel, and then we'll go in this order. So first I have on my left Tun Sarai. He is the founder and president of ADHOC, which is the Cambodian Human Rights and Development Association. It's the first human rights advocacy NGO in Cambodia. He is also the chair of the board of directors of CHRAC, the Cambodian Human Rights Action Committee, and he sits on the board of the Committee for Free and Fair Elections in Cambodia, CONFREL. Next to him is Brad Adams. He's the longtime executive director of Human Rights Watch's Asia Division. He oversees the organization's work on human rights issues in 20 countries, from Afghanistan to the Pacific, but he has specific involvement, long-term involvement in Cambodia itself. He worked for 5 years as the senior lawyer for the Cambodia Field Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights, and he was a legal advisor to the Cambodian Parliament's Human Rights Committee, among other engagements in Cambodia. And finally, at the end of the panel is James Turpin. He is currently Human Rights Officer at the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights and the Acting Chief of Peace and Security Practices Section at the UN in New York. That deals with Security Council engagement on the intersection between human rights and the UN's peace and security agenda. He previously ran the Rule of Law Department for the High Commissioner for Human Rights in Cambodia from, if I got it right, 2006 to 2010. So all people that have a long involvement in this, and look forward to your comments. To you, Tun Sarai.
Thank you, Scott Warden. First of all, I would like to respect Venerable Yohot and Excellency Samrasi and Chulong Samara, and all the ladies and gentlemen. I would like also to thank to the USIP who invited me to come to this panel. You did already listen to the third panel on the macro level of activity from the different countries who involved in the Cambodian conflict to bring peace to Cambodia through the PPA. Peace agreement. For me, I would like to talk to you about the micro level that we are working until today, from the beginning. Yes, Scott Warden said that my organization, we are the first human rights organization. From the early day of the peace agreement, I was released only 16 days before the peace agreement signed. I was put in jail about 17 months in the bad condition. The reason why I had the initiative to set up this human right from that place. Nobody told me that, Tun Sarai, you have to set up this organization, but only my own experience in my life that I have this initiative. I would like to not to take a lot of time. I would like to say that from the first day that we had contributed a lot to the peace process in the aspect of democracy and human rights. Firstly, we organize in the public place, in the first history in our country, the human rights education in the public, in the temple. And a lot of pressure to us in the beginning. But anyway, a lot of people, they inspire peace and human rights respect. They came to attend our human rights training a lot, 100,000 and 100,000 of people that they came with the collaboration with the UN at that time. We succeeded to transform the human rights world to become popular now. Everyone, even in the remote area, the people can use these words. Another thing, we try also to open space for the civic organization. I remember well in 1992, at the end of 1992, when we opened one office in one province, the local authority there, they used more than 100 police, military, and one tank to close down our office there. But we can reopen later on. And after that, we can have the flourishment of the human rights and also different organizations working in different fields established. And now thousands of them, they established, but still survive around 100,000 organizations. We did also provide a lot of protection to the people. I remember well in 1997, we tried to protect the life of the Marine soldiers of the Phnom Penh in our office in Kampong Sam. They escaped through overnight in our office. And next day, I did ask UN High Commissioner office to send their car to bring the two soldiers to Phnom Penh, and we can send them back to their home. Not on this case, but a lot. We provide to protection to the victim of all kind of human rights violation. Apart from this, we also try to encourage, advocate for the establishment of the Khmer Rouge Tribunal, because I remember well when the two last Khmer Rouge leaders defected to the government, our prime minister at that time, he said that if you would like to have peace, we have to forget the past. And at that time, we as Human Rights Action Committee, Coalition of Human Rights Organization, we met immediately whether we should forget the past or not. And later on, we tried to send our message to the people to test them whether they would like to forget the past like our prime minister said or not. But at the end, less than two weeks, we collected more than 80,000 signature and time frame requesting to the international organization, to the UN, to establish an international tribunal. And later on, we can have this kind of hybrid tribunal. What is the present situation now after 25 years? I can say that there are two, I would like to say the positive development first. After the 25 years of human rights education, many Cambodians, they are more aware about their rights and they are to take action to protect their rights by the peaceful way, non-violent ways. And I think at this level of understanding of the Cambodian people, I don't see any political leader, even that they are very powerful, they cannot return back Cambodia to the one-party rule. According to my opinion, I still hope like this. And also another thing is, it's the first time from the 2013 that I see the opposition group, they are not divided like before. They form a coalition among themselves and could have some kind of check and balance in the political system. That is also the positive. I don't like to support any political party as a human rights activist, but for us, we lobby to have this kind of check and balance, because if we allow one ruling party strong and weak opposition, the ruling party, they can do what they want. Civil society organizations according to my observation, now they are vibrant, strong, and linked to the grassroots community, the remote area, the highland people community, that we try to link up this kind of network between the organization and the grassroots community organization. That is a positive, but there are also negative. I would like to say that, as you know, the political space is shrinking all the time. This year, for me, I consider this year is the worst year for our organization in the last 25 years, because before we did receive a lot of threat. Me, I did receive that threat in 2013, yeah, through my email. But my colleague also received also a lot of judicial harassment, but never no one was put in jail. But this time, this year, four of my present colleague and one former colleague was put in jail until today. That means almost 77 months already. And also, I would like to say also the other opponent people also around more than 20 also still in jail. Armed force and judicial system still under the control of the ruling party stronger and stronger. That is also the negative aspect. For me, I also don't like to blame the UN because the UN mission in Cambodia in 1992 and 1993, they failed to disarm the old faction. And they, at the end now, the armed force controlled by one faction, by one party. And also, the UN don't have this kind of post-conflict period follow-up, how to create the mechanism. I don't like to talk only the past crime, the accountability of the past crime, but the present and the future crime too that we need to think. And yeah, I did remember well in 1999 with Human Rights Watch. We did jointly, ad hoc Ligado and Human Rights Watch, we did one report on impunity. And we use this report in order to advocate with the donor community at that time to have the judicial reform, and we have the concrete proposition how to make the judiciary be independent from the government, from the party. But at that time, I still remember well that donors, they don't have the common priority. They focus more on infrastructure, on economic growth, yeah, something like this. And they are divided among themselves. That is a problem also working in this environment, because we don't have the power, like, because community donors, they have the political weight because they have the money. They have also the assistance. They have also the trade with our government. They have some kind of political weight to not to pressure, but I don't like to use the term pressure. Encourage our government to do the reform properly. But anyway, until now, we still have this kind of problem of non-independent of the armed force and the judiciary. And from now on, I think next step, I think that the first thing is to support. I would like to appeal the international community, donors community to support the dialogue. Yeah, I appreciate the Excellency Samransi initiate to dialogue with Prime Minister Hun Sen, but later on this process collapsed. But now it restart again between Hun Sen and Kamsoka. I think that international community, we also civil society organization, we would like to support that kind of dialogue, because this way only that we can solve the problem later on, to bring back the situation into the normal one. Because now we are approaching now the election, 2017 communal election and 2018 general election. And in the electoral process, I observe that some donors, they focus more on the technical aspect. Technical aspect is important, but not enough. The political environment also is more crucial, because to recognize one election process, we have to have free and fair, free participation of the competitor, and fair competition among the different parties into the process. The reason why I would like to say that, firstly, dialogue supported by NGO, international committee, encourage them to continue, not to collapse again. This is my proposition. Second one, I think that we need to think about the future. We should not let the judiciary and armed force be dependent to the one group of people. We have to think about this from now on. And also, I would like to call international community, international organization, and Cambodian people across the country, and also the Cambodian people outside the country, also to think about this, because now our country still have this kind of repeated problem all the time. Yeah, like the circle. Because of this kind of problem, the judiciary and armed force under the control of one group of party, of one group of people. We should make these two institutions, the key one, be independent. That is my suggestion. And for the lesson learned and suggestion recommendation to the next UN mission, I think the next UN mission have to make as much possible how to disarm all the warring faction, because this is a big failure. And you create the problem later on after this mission finish. You create the problem, killing, the fighting in 1997, and also later on a lot of problem of the human rights violation. The serious one, killing, put in jail, judicial harassment, like we see today. Reason why disarm. Second thing is not only the accountability of the past crime, but present and the future crime, judicial reform in the same time, and also the post-conflict period follow-up. That is a very important thing. I would like to stop and to let the other panelists to. Thank you.
Thank you, Brett.
Thank you, Scott, and thank you to USIP for hosting this conference. And before I get to my remarks, I just want to say how impressed I am with people like Tun Sirai, who have not had a stress-free day in 25 years. I mean, working in human rights in Cambodia it's almost masochism. But it's because, you know, he's so principled, and there's so many other people, you know, not just the leaders of the organizations in Cambodia, but so many people who work in them, my former colleagues. I mean, they every day don't know if they personally are going to be attacked, if their colleagues are going to be attacked. This has cut off all sorts of life chances for them to be involved in human rights. It's stigmatizing. It's dangerous. And the same applies for people in the political opposition. People like Sam Ranzi and some more, this isn't a partisan statement, it's just a fact. They've sacrificed a huge amount to get involved in politics to try to make the country better. And of course, we will hold you accountable if you ever get into power and ensure that you do the right thing. There's sometimes an air of unreality in talking about Cambodia from afar and not really talking about what life is like on a daily basis for people who are deeply engaged in the process. It is really, really difficult and tiring. And you know, Tun Sirai has had to be in Canada for a while because the authorities were going to arrest him if he'd stayed. And he's wisely stepped back, tried to let the storm pass. Maybe it's passing now with the pardon of Kem Sokha, and maybe he'd be able to return soon. But it's better to have him out, take a break, and go back and be free than to stay there and fight. And I'm really digressing here, but you know, people who say that Sam Ranzi's a coward for not being in the country and being in a Cambodian jail aren't in his shoes. And I think I hear too much of that from foreigners and diplomats and other people who may not really be able to identify with reality in Cambodia. I just want to pick up a couple of points on UNTAC and then move to the present. When I hear that General Sanderson was willing to use force to cross Khmer Rouge gate, and really what happened was the Khmer Rouge put a barrier down on a road and said, if you cross here, there will be conflict. And there was a big discussion, and I think it was probably sensible not to use force at that point, but not to be willing to use the weight of UNTAC and the international community to enforce the election results, it makes me very sad, because in a way, this is the original sin. Well, this discussion today would be very, very different if General Sanderson and UNTAC and headquarters in New York had decided that they were going to call Hun Sen's bluff in 1993 when he lost the election and say, no, we will enforce the election results. How would Cambodia have looked if they had done that? We can't say. But one thing I think we can be sure of is Hun Sen would have left the scene. The CPP was relying entirely on Hun Sen. He said, I will carry you to the victory line. And he failed. And through interviews I've done and other people have done, we know that the CPP was talking about getting rid of Hun Sen at that point, the most malignant figure in the country. He's now been in power for 31 years. The man who is behind, not solely, but behind much of the UNTAC violence, which claimed at least 200 lives of opposition political party figures, the brains of the CPP, the person who singularly has the capacity to keep the CPP in power, was kept in power and propped up by that decision by the UN not to confront the CPP and Hun Sen when they refused to accept the election results. So the fruit of the poisonous tree can easily be followed from that decision. My personal judgment is that the Cambodian Armed Forces would have run to the hills if they had been confronted by UNTAC. They were not going to be prepared to fight to preserve the CPP's position. Many of them voted for the opposition. We know that, of course, as well. In fact, we know that now. Every election, we know that significant portions of the security apparatus actually privately support the opposition. And so we just can't glide over that. I was at the 5 years ago at I have a deja vu today, because 5 years ago in Berkeley, we had a conference on the 20th anniversary of the Paris Peace Agreements. Dick Solomon was there, and he made a very strong presentation about this very point, that there just wasn't leadership and there wasn't resolve to at least test the CPP instead of rolling over and creating this bizarre, ridiculous situation where you have co-prime ministers. And then, of course, and this is not so different from where we are in Burma right now, we then have the winner of the election in a coalition in Burma, it's the NLD with the army, having to sort of defend the state. And so Fun Sim Pek, and we can all talk about the failures of Prince Ranarid, which were almost infinite, very poor leadership. Corrupt. I mean, here's a man who said that, I'm taking money, but I'm the prime minister. Why shouldn't I take a commission when the government signs a deal? I mean, he just thought that was why I'm in government. I should be able to get rich. So he had his failings, but he was forced into this shotgun marriage where he was defending what the CPP did because it was a coalition government of not of his choosing. He and his party did not want that, and I think, Randy and Samar, you may have something to say about that if you want. So let's just not forget context. I think it's absolutely essential. When UNTAC left is when I arrived, and I do want to say that UNTAC, many people in UNTAC did fantastic work. It was an unbelievably challenging situation, and there were many successes. But you know, people have written books about that, and I, if you give me the liberty, I want to focus on some of the challenges. There was virtually no planning post-UNTAC. It's really kind of incredible. It's sort of like after the United States invaded Iraq. You know, the State Department did a lot of planning, but it was thrown out by Rumsfeld. Here, there were a lot of people doing planning, but it was basically never prioritized. And so when I arrived, the UN Human Rights Office couldn't pay for fuel to run the generator to keep the air conditioning lights on in their office because provision hadn't been made. Literally, I'm not joking, literally the office had to shut down at one point because provision hadn't been made to fund the operation. There was there was no, there was almost nobody from UNTAC stayed to try to guide the post-UNTAC process from peacekeeping to peacebuilding, as people would say. And the same was true for many key countries. The United States being an exception. Charles Twining stayed. Mark's not here anymore. Mark stayed for a while. There was some transition. But here's another key point, and we shouldn't avoid. Dick Solomon, I've interviewed him for a book that I should have written a long time ago that will someday appear. But he said, the honest answer is that we got into Cambodia, we, the international community, to get out of Cambodia. There was not a commitment from the rest of the world to get into Cambodia, to stay, to see it through the problems of the long term. This was one of the world's great geopolitical hotspots. Relationships were tangled between China, the United States, Soviet Union, Vietnam. Normalization with Vietnam was impossible without sorting out Cambodia, et cetera. All these relationships had to be untangled. Cambodia was one of the knots. Afghanistan was another knot. There were other places that, but this was a key place. And so, you know, he was pejoratively called by James Baker, the Assistant Secretary for Cambodia. Baker was not happy with how much time, according to Solomon, he was putting into Cambodia. But it was necessary. And I believe his commitment was sincere, as was the commitment of some other people. But that's not really what this enterprise was about. The Paris Peace Agreements were not really about getting into Cambodia and solving what was going to be a generational problem. It was to get in, declare victory, and leave. And that brings me to my next point, which is we've seen since UNTAC a replacement of political engagement with development aid. And that has provided an excuse for a lot of countries to say, yes, we're still committed. Look, we're giving money to some human rights groups here and some development organizations there, and we're building roads and bridges. But that is not a substitute for actually grappling with the country's problems and trying to provide solutions. And yes, there have been some excellent individual diplomats. There have been times when there have been pushes from outside to try to focus on human rights and democracy. But in total, since 1993, to the last 23 years, basically most countries don't want to talk about Cambodia. And they wanted to check it off the list of problem countries and move on to the next burning hotspot. Understandably, it's understandable that countries have to deal with the burning problems of the day, but you cannot congratulate yourself and pat yourself on the back for a job well done if you make a short-term commitment, use very flowery language, and then basically move all of your political capital elsewhere and leave it to what I would really not pejoratively say, but in terms of the hierarchy of these governments, to your second and third string. Your top diplomats, no longer interested, no longer involved, very hard to get them engaged, except when a crisis happens, which brings me to the next problem. And this is something that Tun Sirai talked about. The hopes of Cambodians were raised dramatically by the Paris Peace Agreements and by UNTAC, rightly so, because let's face it, Cambodia went through genocide and every other problem because of external involvement. Cambodia had been an island and had not had any connection with the outside world. It's very unlikely there ever would have been a revolution, unlikely there would have been the Khmer Rouge coming to power, unlikely there would have been all these deaths and destruction in the country. The world had a responsibility for what happened in Cambodia. It's not really a very contestable fact. But they raised all these expectations about democracy. I've talked about the fact they didn't enforce the election. Security sector reform, Sirai talked about this. Not only did they not disarm and demobilize the factions, we have this problem that lingers till today, that France came in because they wanted to compete with other donors, and they recreated the Gendarmerie, a third force that's absolutely unnecessary for Cambodia. They armed it, and it's become a Praetorian Guard for Hun Sen. So they didn't just fail to do what they said they would do in the Paris Agreements. They came in and made the problem worse. And Sao Saka, who's the head of the Gendarmerie, has been so for 20 years, is essentially Hun Sen's primary thug. Even today, there was a story in the newspaper that he said that he made a speech to the gendarmes and the military saying, you must vote for the CPP in the next election. because they're actually afraid that they're going to lose the next election. But, you know, as Sarai was saying, a very highly politicized institution, very well armed. You know, the gendarmes have the best kit in the country. They got the best guns. They got the best uniforms. They got the best boots. They got the best salaries. Started by France, a country that would say that they were all about human rights in Cambodia. Why did they do this? Because, and this is the this is one of the other original sins. There's a misunderstanding about the nature of Hun Sen and the CPP. Almost from the beginning. Many diplomats were dealing with Hun Sen. He was seen as the liberal in the regime. He was the guy you could negotiate with. He's definitely the smartest guy in the regime. He's the most capable person, but he's also the most dangerous, the most violent, and the least trustworthy. But for years, diplomats and foreign ministries around the world, and some of my UN, former UN colleagues, thought this was the guy who was pushing the CPP towards reform. And in fact, what we know is that's not true at all. He was actually the most hardline guy in the CPP. And so regularly mistakes were made in empowering Hun Sen in various ways. You know, not least by repeated visits. You know, those of us who are living there were just constantly shocked by visits by visiting diplomats from various countries, including the United States, who would stand up with Hun Sen in public, on stage, be photographed, end up on national TV, extolling the progress Cambodia was making. And Cambodians would say, what in the world is going on? How can you stand with Hun Sen, this bloody dictatorial type person, and say that the country is making progress, thereby pulling the rug out from under Tun Sarai, the opposition, and other people, and making their jobs much harder. A couple of last points. When people sometimes glibly say that Cambodians got to solve their own problems, I've already said the problems were, you know, partially caused externally, and there's a continuing obligation for the rest of the world to stay engaged with Cambodia at a high level and deeply, not superficially. And the next opportunity for this is going to be the 2018 elections. If the rest of the world basically says, oh, it's just Cambodia, what do you expect? We're going to continue to be prisoners of the poverty of low expectations. We have this problem in Cambodia. There are still very low expectations. Well, it doesn't have a democratic history. It doesn't have a democratic culture. You know, well, I beg to differ. You know, Cambodians, as Tun Sarai said, have been exposed to these concepts for a very long time. It's deeply embedded in Cambodian culture now, in political culture, that there should be elections every 5 years, that the winner should take power. They should be free and fair. And so what we need is not a compact. I don't think we can have a reaffirmation by the 18 signatories of the Paris Peace Agreements, but it would be great to have a compact among the donor community and Cambodia's friends about what is expected in 2018 and be very explicit about it. You know, yes, there has to be an independent National Election Commission. Yes, there has to be free and equal access to the media. Yes, there has to be an independent complaints resolution mechanism, et cetera, all those things. And when things start to go wrong or there's problems, there will be a high level contact group that will intervene and address these things publicly. Is that certain to lead to a democratic outcome? No, it's going to be very complicated. But it's the only way that we can provide a foundation where that's possible. So I will end there, and I'm happy to talk about these other things later again.
Thank you very much, James.
Thank you. coming last, after all these high-level experts that really know what they're talking about, I feel a bit of a fraud being here, particularly as I'm actually... The person who should be sitting here is the Special Rapporteur, Rona Smith, who was invited and unfortunately just couldn't arrange to be here. I wanted to also... apart from thanking USIP and everyone for organizing this, join Brad's tribute to the human rights defenders in Cambodia. This year's Human Rights Day, the theme was stand up for rights, but also stand up for those that stand up for rights. And it's very much at the heart of what we try to do in the Office of the High Commissioner to support those in country who are pushing for respect for human rights. So I very much join that recognition. Being asked to come here today is a strange mix of emotions for me because it allows me to reflect a little bit on my past and my present, in the sense that I was in Cambodia for 4 years now, left 6 years ago. But now I'm very much working with the Office of High Commissioner in New York on human rights in the peace and security agenda. And so it's allowed me to think a little bit how something like the Paris Peace Accords has an impact on the way that we work in the field, but also how we might do it differently now, given that there's 25 years of experience. UNTAC, in a sense, is still alive in Cambodia in the sense that the Office of the High Commissioner is a continuation of that effort that was in the Peace Accords. It's the oldest field presence of OSHR, and it's actually older than the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, because the post of High Commissioner for Human Rights was actually only created in December of 1993, when UNTAC wound up and the office was established. What I'm going to talk about is a little bit about how the UN now deals with these issues, and then a little bit about how I think it helped me in the work we were doing and how we should continue that work. And it speaks to the three stages, I guess, of the process: the peacemaking, the peacekeeping, and the peacebuilding. And these are the buzzwords in the UN that we now use that probably didn't exist at that time. In terms of the peacekeeping, the UN presence that was established in UNTAC, as was said earlier, it had a fairly comprehensive mandate under the Accords. It was for human rights education, which we would now broaden to capacity building generally, and that's certainly something the office still does in Cambodia. General oversight of human rights and investigation and corrective action, those were the three areas. Since then, peacekeeping operations have been transformed. I mean, UNTAC was an experiment. It was a new type of thing alongside the missions in El Salvador and Guatemala. In 1999, there was the Bohemia Report, which was looking at the way peacekeeping was done. Since then, human rights components have been a standard part of peacekeeping missions. And it's not just about doing human rights work in an isolation under the umbrella of the mission. It's very much about helping the mission as a whole achieve its mandate, which is peace and security. So the development of that framework has really been completely transformed. And in a sense, it's quite surprising. I was talking to a colleague in the office who deals with our support for peace missions, and she was quite surprised to know that there was this component in a peace mission that early on, because really since 1999 that this effort really developed. So in that sense, UNTAC was quite pioneering. And the core elements of monitoring and reporting and then capacity building and advocacy to try and identify human rights challenges and then address them in some way is still very much the heart of what we try to do in all of our peacekeeping missions, with success and lack of success. That's not to say that UNTAC was a great success, and I think there are certain areas where it was very clear to me working in Cambodia that there had been missed opportunities. I think reform of the judiciary was one, the one area I was particularly working on, and institution building in general. The other problem that I used to curse my UN colleagues for was the UNTAC law, and particularly the provision on criminal defamation, which we had to deal with all the time. So it wasn't that the UN wasn't also in some ways part of the problem, even when it was trying to bring about reform. So in that sense, UNTAC was part of, or the beginning of what's actually become quite a sophisticated system, and a lot's been learned about how to be more effective in those kind of missions that perhaps would have made a better framework at that time if it had been available. The second element is the peacemaking, the actual accords themselves and what it set out for Cambodia over in the future in terms of establishing the country. In that sense, it was for us quite surprising, but we were very grateful for the fact that human rights is very much at the core of that agreement, by chance or by design. And specifically the undertakings to protect human rights on the part of the government and to ratify treaties was a real benefit for us in terms of what we tried to do on the ground. It's sometimes forgotten that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the treaties that then flowed from that was designed as a conflict prevention and conflict resolution tool. It was a response to what happened in the Second World War, and it was about trying to identify what had gone wrong and how you might correct it and setting some standards. I think what for me is very clear, and Scott, you mentioned this at the beginning, this false dichotomy between stability and human rights is something that we constantly have to push against. It's often said that human rights are a symptom of conflict, but if they're a symptom of conflict, they get driven by conflict. Addressing them can actually be a mechanism for resolving the conflict itself. But taking that a step further, you're looking at, in effect, the root causes of conflict. So if you fail to address them, you're kind of sowing the seeds for the conflicts in the future. And in that sense, if you try to say that it's inappropriate for the international community, for the UN, to be looking at these internal issues, it doesn't really work. Because, in fact, the provisions on the continuing UN work on human rights are in the agreement on integrity, territorial integrity, inviolability, neutrality, and so on, of Cambodia. The fact that they're in that agreement, I think, says something about that, that it's actually about making a more stable country that you start to address these issues. So in that sense, what was in the accords then gave us the anchor to carry on doing our work in Cambodia and to this day. Now, it was mentioned earlier that there's a specific provision about the role of the Commission on Human Rights, which is now the Human Rights Council, and the creation of the Special Rapporteur. In some sense, the Office of the High Commissioner is also part of that continuing effort. And I wanted to say a few words about how that dynamic of the relationship between violations of human rights and peace should still be part of that equation in terms of the work we do. If you look at some of the challenges which have been talked about, a weak judiciary that's not independent, the shrinking civil society space and the lack of freedom of expression, assembly, association, these issues, but also the challenges to economic, social, and cultural rights, which I saw very much as a new element, a result of how Cambodia was developing, but that there were large numbers of people who were not the beneficiaries of the development aid that Brad, you talked about, but were becoming victims of it, that it was being done in a way that had real harm to the poorest in society. That somehow, if you turn those round, a strong judiciary, one that can give redress to victims, that brings accountability, very much, as Tun Sarai said, for present and future crimes, not just about the past, creates the kind of institution that promotes stability. And that's why we need to be working on that, and that's why it was a missed opportunity in the past. A vibrant civil society, where you can express yourself, where you can protest. This is the kind of society that holds governments to account, that demands a responsive and accountable government. That kind of a government will address the real concerns on the ground. And so it's a more stable society in that sense. And a development agenda that captures everyone is the kind of society that is more stable than one where half the people are actually being left behind or even victimized by. So in that sense, the work we're doing now, and I picked those three areas because they're the three main focuses of the Office of the High Commissioner now, in terms of thematic areas, are about how we move this forward. They draw from the past, from the Paris Peace Accords, but they're translating it into the future. And they tie into modern approaches, and I would highlight the two, the Sustainable Development Goals, which is about that long-term thinking about this kind of development that you need to make stable societies. And a new agenda, which has just come up this year, which is called Sustaining Peace, which is really about broadening peace building beyond this short-term transition and carrying it on into the future to make sure that we're not sowing the seeds for the next conflict. And I think in some sense that's what needs to be the focus now. Okay, it's good to look back 25 years, but we've got to look forward as well. The presence of the Office of the High Commissioner there, the presence of a vibrant civil society in Cambodia is an important element to make sure that the Cambodia of the future isn't heading towards the next conflict. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, it's never finished business. There's never an end to a peace process because it's a constant process of making sure that we're moving in the right direction. In the same sense that in any country in the world, there's never a point where you have protected and guaranteed human rights. It's that ongoing continual vigilance that's required. And the Paris Peace Accords were unusual because somehow, by accident or design, they put in that far-reaching vigilance element that allows us to continue to do the work we're doing today on the ground. Thank you.
Thank you very much, highlighting the current issues and linking that with the legacy of the PPA. We have a little over 20 minutes for questions. I want to turn it to the audience. If I could see a show of hands, and then a microphone will come find you. Let me start with the front here.
Thank you. My name is Janet Tseng. I'm the president of Women for CNLP in North America. First of all, I'd like to thank Rupu Donsaray and Mr. Brad Adam for spending 25 years without a day of stress-free. Thank you. My question is to Mr. James Turbin. I understand you spoke of the future plan, but what are you doing in an immediate situation regarding the four people that's in prison right now, the human rights defender? Because I know it threatened the human right itself in Cambodia, because if the human right defender themselves are in prison, how are people to believe that we have right in Cambodia? Thank you.
Are there other questions? We'll take another one right now. Go ahead.
Thank you. I have to say I'm not here to represent the office in Phnom Penh, and I would very much defer to my colleagues there on what they're actually doing on these cases. What I can say is that when we face that kind of a situation in any country in the world, there's a lot of work that's done publicly and a lot of work that's done behind the scenes to try and resolve the situation. But I would then refer back to I guess what I was trying to say in my intervention, which is that you do have a framework in Cambodia to work with. And the treaties themselves, the human rights treaties, are law. They are part of the constitution. And when things happen that don't conform with those basic standards, it is a collective effort of those within the country and those outside the country to try and point that out. So it's, in a sense, what part of that broader effort that I described of monitoring and reporting and then trying to resolve. So don't assume that because you don't hear our office loudly pointing out those kind of things that it's not working as hard as it can to resolve it. Sometimes what's happening behind the scenes can be more powerful.
Can I just ask a follow-up question to engage Brad and Sunsarai on this, which is, on the one hand, I wonder if it's a silver lining, and I observe this in Afghanistan and some other countries, where the reaction, so imprisoning human rights defenders, almost shows you where there is vulnerability, in a sense of vulnerability in a regime that is seeking to hold on to power. And where they find threat, then you see a strong reaction. I wonder about that, and then also, you know, Brad, your discussion of the original SIM back in the UNTAC days. I mean, to what extent, in both of your experience, is there a real communication through incidents like this with human rights violations, testing reactions both from Cambodian society but also the international community to see how far can I press this and how vulnerable am I to change?
First, just everyone should know that the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, which has been there since 1994, is facing a threat of closure on December 31st by the government. The government has publicly said that they will close the office if a new memorandum of understanding is not completed. I've been in touch with the office in the last 12 hours, actually, and that there's some hope that there may be an agreement, but there's no agreement. And this is in direct retaliation for the work of the office in speaking out, particularly about attacks on the political opposition and civil society. So OHCHR itself is under threat right now in a way it hasn't been since 1995, when Hun Sen and Prince Ranarid announced that it would be closed, and then that was reversed by diplomatic interventions. So the situation is very unstable right now. My understanding of how Hun Sen operates is he's always pushing towards the limits and seeing where the reaction is. And when there isn't a reaction, when domestically or internationally, he keeps pushing. Now, there's always a reaction domestically. Always. Very courageous people have always stood up to Hun Sen and said what they needed to say, but they are only sometimes backed up internationally. And when he perceives weakness or disunity internationally, he pushes forward further. I think he pushed because there's not a very strong set of diplomats in Phnom Penh right now. There's not much focus on Cambodia internationally for a variety of good and bad reasons. He pushed too far in this case. And the reason we saw a pardon of Khem Sokha, the deputy leader of the opposition, and we understand there's a process in which it looks like the ad hoc staff members will be released and other charges will be dropped and other people will be released from prison, is because there was a belated backlash from the diplomatic community and not insignificantly from Japan signing a joint statement very recently expressing concern, which I think may have signaled to him that he couldn't play the international community off against each other as successfully as he wanted to. But I will say that he will exit this having lost almost nothing, Hun Sen. And that's been the pathology for years and years. He can push to the line, he can push across the line, including extrajudicial killings, imprisonment, very blatant use of the judiciary. He's telling the judiciary in public to arrest people and to convict them. He's not even hiding the fact that he's controlling the judiciary. But then it's business as usual. There's been no cost for him or the CPP for doing these things. So he simply, it's a tactical withdrawal, and next month or next year, he can do the same thing.
Just for me, I think the role of the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights in Cambodia is a delicate one. Yeah, I did say to many special rapporteurs in Cambodia that if you are too critical, you will receive the closed door from the government side, or they will reject to sign the MOU, something like this with you. If you are too soft and no progress, you will lose your credibility. You see, the reason why the UN have to balance all the time between critical and soft approach. Like James, sometimes he said that. Yeah, he just said that. Sometimes the soft approach, that means talking with the government behind the scene is more effective than openly. Yeah, I don't mind, but the problem is how to make the situation progress. That is very important. We don't like the UN all the time to be critical, but please to make the situation progress, advance step by step. But sometimes some approach, the situation still get worse and worse. Reason why the recent mission of the UN Special Rapporteur, a lot of NGO, they are also not happy with the UN Special Rapporteur report. But the last report of the UN Special Rapporteur is improving, and we are happy with that. The reason why I cannot say what they should do, but it depends on the person who are in charge of this mission, who have to find a way, the best way. Sometimes it's art, also not a science. It's an art how to deal with this tough government. I would like to say.
Thank you. I saw other hands. The gentleman on the right, you please.
Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. My name is Kim Ho-Do. I am a co-founder and also a senior member and advisor of the organization called Cambodia, Khmer People for Network for Cambodia. In abbreviation is KPNC. And I have some kind of question, but also like a clarification. I want to see whether the that clarification might help Cambodian people to understand clearly that in the context of applying or implementing the Paris Peace Agreement, the UN can even put troops in Cambodia without violating any sovereignty of Cambodia, because what's his name, Sok Aisan, keep claiming that Cambodia has sovereignty and that nobody can come in and dictate this and that. I tried to check the Paris Peace Agreement. I see the point that when to implement that, UN can really put the even troop in Cambodia to do the job, to get the job done. Is there any such a thing? Like I understand, I want people to understand. If the Cambodian people understand, put be a pressure rather than to allow Hun Sen to keep lying to them, okay? And to sound so good that, hey, we have to protect our own country, that's a nice thing, so he do a good job, and so a kind of ignoring the a commitment of the United Nations. Thank you.
Let me take a few questions. I saw a bunch of hands, Samora.
Thank you.
Samora,
thank you for the very good presentations each one of you made. I would like just to come back on a point that has been raised by Brad Adams, I think, that the Paris Peace Accords have been signed because the international community wanted to come to Cambodia to get out of it. I can understand that being the international community or a member of the international community, I want to get rid of a problem that embarrasses the rest of the world. The problem is if any member of the international community, especially the US, wanted to come to Cambodia to get out of it, they did it in the wrong way. I can understand it. If I were a leader of a major country in the world, I wouldn't like to be embarrassed with problems of genocide and maybe presently breeding grounds for terrorism or organized crime or the way Cambodia is now. But the thing is that they did it the wrong way. How could they have done it in the right way? James Turpin mentioned sustainable development. The development and the economic growth that we are having now in Cambodia is not sustainable. It is not fairly distributed, so that one out of three Cambodians earns less than $1 a day. Two out of three Cambodians earn less than $2 a day. This is not the recipe for sustainable growth or even development. We have in Cambodia blatant violations of the basic rights. For instance, for a population that is 85% represented by farmers,
we have massive land grabs. How do farmers live without land? And I don't even mention the negligence of the authorities of the present ruling party, because they don't even provide us with any irrigation or any infrastructure to deal with monsoon rains that are a that become a disaster each year for the crops of the farmers. So we are, with the way the government is ruling the country now, we are creating a big, huge problem. And so the international committee came to Cambodia, but they didn't get out of it the other way around. Very soon, the international committee will have to face a big crisis in Cambodia, and then they will have to get in again. So why not do it the right way by addressing the problems one after the other? For instance, Cambodia is ruled by a dictator. Don't let him get away with crimes, even crimes against humanity. Don't let him get away with crimes against the environment, because the environment is a universal problem. Take him to account for all the wrong things that he's doing to his own people, to his own country, to his own environment. And why grant to these Cambodian rulers trade privileges that do not benefit our workers? Because our workers earn a mere $150 per month. How can they live a decent life out of it? And why give those privileges to such a country? Why grant Cambodia the legitimacy of a properly ruled country that will use its financial institutions for money laundering? This is not good for the rest of the world either, to have such a big sinkhole and a big loophole in whatever system the world order has established in order to have a good, equitable way to rule the world. So my point is that as long as we say, oh, well, Cambodia is good enough and big enough now and should run by herself. No, this is the recipe towards another genocide, another Khmer Rouge type of rule, because we don't have now a genocide the way we had under the Khmer Rouge. That was blatant and visible. But actually, when you force farmers to live without land, it is just condemning them to finally death. So I launched a vibrant appeal to the international community. You cannot get out of Cambodia that way. Do it properly, and then within the next 5-10 years, maybe you will be able to get out of Cambodia, and Cambodia, instead of being the beggar of the world, will be able to contribute to the world order. Thank you.
Thank you, and I saw one other hand, Paul.
Yeah, I'm Paul Randolph. I served in Cambodia from 2004 to 2009 for USAID. I'm no longer with USAID, speaking for myself. At that time, there's some repeating, as you've already mentioned on the panel, there's repeating cycles that go on in the manipulations of the political system and so on in Cambodia. New Year's Eve 2005 for Kem Sokha and four other human rights workers were imprisoned. And now we're back to that cycle again. And I think one of the things that we talked a lot about at that time of that situation was, what are the different levers of how you put pressure to adhere to the human rights conventions and the rule of law that's embedded in the constitution in Cambodia? And you've talked a lot about, government, civil society, international donors and diplomats. But one of the things that seemed to have the most influence in 2005 in that situation, 2006, and I think today, was how you leverage the private sector. And the speaker just mentioned, the garment factories and garment buyers and so on. And how do you leverage them today to bring influence onto this regime? Because it seemed as if that was one lever that actually could have potential of getting them to make more rapid decisions and has actually a greater influence across the ruling party than some of the diplomatic efforts that have been attempted, because it's so difficult to get them unified. So just kind of today, moving forward, is that something you're looking at, and how do you utilize private sector, international business, and so on to have influence there? Because there's more and more presence, the Japanese influence you mentioned. Part of that is today there's more Japanese companies in Cambodia than there were 10 years ago.
Thank you. Let me just ask each of the panelists, maybe in order to address those issues that you see fit, starting with Tun Sarai.
I think the different 2005 and now, I think at that time, hot science still not strong enough like today, not powerful enough like today. He still not control his party 100% like today. At that time, U.S. still have some influence because he still would like to have the legitimacy of his power with the election. And at that time, he still hope to win the election because the opposition, they are still divided. They were divided among themselves. But this time, it's different because the opposition now, they have more, like I said, some kind of check and balance with the ruling. And also, some people said that he is now frightened to lose the power because of this. Because from 2008 until now, especially after 2008, when he got 90 seats, he found that he's very proud that what he did in the past is right because the people still support him more and more. Reason why, according to my opinion, I could be wrong. From 2008, he did a lot of mistake policy, especially on land, on forest. You see, he provide a lot of land economic concession to the private company. According to the statistic that my organization found, in 2011, more than 1 million hectare provided to the private company, and it's a mess because. The private company tried to grab the land of the people. According to the policy at the national level, they said that they use the tiger skin policy. That means they allow the people live there, cultivate on their land. But in the practice, it's not. The private company, when they got the contract from the government, they tried to bulldoze the house, bulldoze the land of the people. They try to evict the people by force, by pressure to them with the small compensation. That make a lot of people angry with the policy, that policy. Reason why to get back the popularity, it's a little bit, I don't know, late on or still working, I don't know, but for the reason why. And now it seems that he is very sensitive with the pressure from international community. You see, before, okay, still, US or Japan still work with. But according to our channel with some Japanese NGO, something like this, now it's hard because now they're concerned subsidy to have the close relationship with China too. And now, as you know, that Chinese assistant to the Cambodian government now a lot, billion and billion US dollar. The reason why, but for me, I think sometimes our government also bluffing also because of from the Chinese assistant is not enough, according to my opinion. I could be wrong too, because the Chinese government provided only the credit, not the grant, not especially the loan. And not for the solving the deficit of national budget, but for just only infrastructure, you see. And also now Chinese government has the policy to combat against corruption in their own country. Reason why they cannot spend the money to waste their money for one government to for their own deficit of budget. That is the problem. I think that I for me. The problem is we have, like I suggest in my speech, that culture of dialogue still working. We have to support this kind of culture of dialogue in order to find a compromise solution. And I think the quiet diplomacy also does work also, because now you can say it's very sensitive with the open critic, you see. But if quiet diplomacy, talking with him, yeah, I did suggest to many country representatives already during my travel to Geneva or to Bangkok and to everywhere. I try to suggest to find the best, the good mediator in the world in order to find the solution, not the big. But Hun Sen also rejected many times already that, no, I don't like to have anybody from outside to reconcile our problem. We Khmer, we can solve the problem among Khmer people. That is the way that he say. But for me, I think that international still have political way, because from the West, from Europe, and from United States, we have a lot of trade with our government. Our Cambodia economy cannot export. Our country cannot export the government product to China. Only China can export product to Cambodia. And also the how to solve the deficit of budget, I think they cannot rely on the Chinese financial assistance, only with from the West. Reason why I think that the West still have the political weight. But how to make this political weight working? That is the way I think that you have to think by yourself, because I cannot say to you, but you have to think how to make that. Jointly, separately, quietly, openly, up to you. You can measure on that. I think that's work, still work, because rely on the Chinese assistant, I don't think that is it's correct. And it's my own opinion, but I still continue to support the idea to have the dialogue. But in the same time, by the different way, the international community, especially from the West, they still have the way to not. I don't like to say pressure, because if he heard that I use the word pressure, he will also sensitive with this kind of word of pressure. But I don't like to say pressure, but what if one you say, but try to encourage or to support something like this, the way how to bring back the situation into normal, and accept to have the free and fair process of election. Nobody lost for this way, because the opposition don't like to take revenge if they win the election. And also the government don't lose anything, because I think that the government have also already the money, they have already the structure, they have also the network also. Yeah, we can say frankly, not just only bluffing also the situation, because the CPP they stay there many years, and they have their network. Why they are too frightened about this situation? This is why I think that we have to convince the CPP side that they have to accept this kind of process, because Jen said, the important spirit, the key spirit of the peace agreement, the PPA, is to prevent the return back of Cambodia to the bad practice in the past, in the recent history of Cambodia. Because how to prevent that? It's the democracy and respect of human rights. And if you block the process to have the free and fair election, how you block the competition of powers through the peaceful way, what is the different political group? What they do? They have to use the human way. If they don't see the peaceful way how to compete the power. That is a very important thing, that to prevent that kind of returning back to the bad practice, that means the fighting for power, we have to respect the democracy, the democratic principle, free and fair election. That is I think that we have to convince the other side, the Cambodian government, the ruling party, that you have to realize that without this, how you can have the sustainable development reconstruction, because the peace agreement, you should not focus only on the development process alone, because the peace process mentioned clearly that the linkage between the development process, reconstruction process, with the respect of democracy and human rights. Without this,
Cambodia will go to the, will lead to the dangerous situation that could return back to the past, bad practice of the past. Bad practice of the past, fighting for power, violent for power. You see, we have to highlight this again and again in order to find a compromise solution that everyone have the benefit to go with this process of democratization and respect of human rights. Not only the development alone, but with respect of human rights and democracy. Without this, how you can have the sustainable development if there are the violence again in the future? I would like to stop. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me know, we are over time, but I do want to give the other panelists a chance to respond, and please.
Very briefly. Cambodia is not going to go back, in my view, to kind of armed conflict with formed armies, and that's not really on the table. But what is on the table is that the country is going to face a crisis in 2018 if there isn't a strategy and a plan to try to support the democratic process. Because what we saw in 2013, and which has only become stronger, is that there is a groundswell of support in the country for change. We see it all over the world. We're seeing it in Cambodia. It's getting stronger. It's led by younger people. They have no allegiance to the CPP because they don't really credit it with having done anything for them. They didn't live through the period when the CPP was protecting the country against the Khmer Rouge. And so we are going to see the possibility of a social explosion very soon if the elections are not handled properly. On the other hand, I do not believe in the culture of dialogue if it means concessions only by one side, which is what we've largely seen so far. Nor do I believe that the CPP led by Hun Sen can be reasoned with, because they're not interested in sustainable development. That's not their goal. Their goal is to maintain and expand their power and their wealth, and to create a patronage network that will protect them in power indefinitely, in perpetuity. And so, really, you can't say pressure, I understand that. I can, and I think all of us should, because that is what is necessary. There needs to be a strategy to put pressure that needs to be joined up by every major player. And here, I do have some hope about China, not because I think they want democratization, but because they've had a very bad experience in Burma very recently. They've overstretched. There's going to be a parlor game for a generation to figure out why did the reform process in Burma start. But almost anybody you speak to will say that one element was an over-reliance on China. China had too big a footprint. And that is the case in Cambodia today as well. There's a resentment building towards China because they seem to be propping up the regime in Phnom Penh. So, in short, we need a strategy. It needs to be joined up. It needs to be led. The United States is in a position to do that, although who knows what the next administration is going to be interested in doing. But we haven't seen that in the past. And I'll just give one cautionary tale. In my mind, the first 5 years after UNTAC were the most important. That's when the die was cast for what we have right now. And the international community failed miserably. They didn't stand up to Hun Sen after his coup. They didn't stand up to him in 1998 when he staged a very bloody election and killed many, many opposition members. We saw monks floating, dead corpses of monks floating down the Mekong and the Tonle Basak rivers in full view, and they stood back. They stood back and they let it happen because they decided the devil they knew was better than the risk it would take to try to sort the problem out. And I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be alarmist, but I believe we can see the same scenario happening in the coming years if Hun Sen tries to put a lid on this pressure cooker, which is building in Cambodia.
Quick final thought.
Thank you. Just quickly on the three questions, I think there is no threat to sovereignty to engage with the international human rights system. There is a threat to sovereignty if you don't, because violations of human rights fuel conflict, and conflict's bad for sovereignty. So that's our basic argument on that. Coupled with that, you have specific provisions of the peace accords, the treaties, being a member state of the UN, that it requires you to engage with that. On Samura's points about in, out, leaving too fast, I think that's exactly the point, and it's a lesson that's been learned not just in Cambodia, but in many countries, if you look at Burundi now and Central African Republic and so on. And it's really what's behind these initiatives like sustainable development, sustaining peace. It's about thinking longer term and trying to connect the dots better and make sure that everyone is brought under these, the benefits from these processes in a really effective way. On enforcing treaties, you know, human rights generally, I would refer to the Working Group on Business and Human Rights, which has been looking exactly at those issues of private sector engagement and so on. It's a mechanism of the Human Rights Council, and it's done some interesting work. In Cambodia, and this is my final thought, it's the thing I'm most proud of, that we used the treaties. The treaties are part of Cambodian law. We brought a case with NGOs to the Constitutional Council on a specific issue of children being locked up for misdemeanors, in effect. And it was a confluence of issues of the judiciary feeling under pressure and not applying the Convention on the Rights of the Child. That case, everyone said, would fail because the Constitutional Council had no authority or power and because it wasn't clear that the treaties applied. But the Constitutional Council ruled that the treaties do apply, and the court started to enforce it. And it was in an area where these issues, these big issues of the political context, weren't coming through so much. And it showed that you can do useful human rights work on the ground to make a difference. And my assertion is, and why I'm so proud of it, is because I know that there are thousands of children that never ended up in a Cambodian jail because of that ruling. And that's an important gain for us in an area where there's an awful lot of lack of success. So thank you.
Let's end on a positive note. I apologize to those that did not get a chance to ask their questions. The two takeaways that I have from this, one is from the first panel and the great observation that there is no end date on the Paris Peace Accords, and this idea that there, and I think it's useful to think about what does the signature mean of all the countries that supported that and other peace agreements in terms of an obligation to see those commitments through over time. And I think we've heard, you know, some recommendations on ways that implicit commitment maybe can be fulfilled even today. And the second thing is, you know, Brad highlighted and others, you know, cost of early decisions. Obviously, nobody can predict the future and the consequences if you choose different paths. But I think it's always a good reminder that, you know, those key decisions shouldn't be taken lightly. And you should at least envision future paths and not see it as a short-term versus long-term choice, but rather, you know, two long-term choices that need to be weighed carefully and realistically against each other. Let me close with thank yous. Thank you both to Laura McGrew for helping to organize, as we mentioned earlier, but really, this would not be possible if it wasn't for Rachel Vandenbrink, who's standing in the back. She's contacted many of you, instrumental and super hard work in bringing this all together, so thank you, Rachel. And finally, let me thank the audience. Clearly, many of you have a long investment in Cambodia and will have a continuing one. Thank you for being here. I'm glad that we could raise this issue, commemorate the 25th anniversary of the Peace Accords, and look ahead to future engagement in Cambodia. So thank you all.